Welcome to the podcast that questions everything, from conspiracies to philosophy, from science to religion. We'll be looking at the construct of the illusion, and as always, we will question everything. Hello, Rob Wallace. This is obviously Everything's an Illusion podcast. I'm your host, Rob Wallace. Today I have Davey McConaughey of DMC Fitness, of Magic Minds, and of Ubuntu. So that's three different companies that Davey runs. We're going to be looking at how to become successful in business. We're going to be asking questions about the business mentality, businessmanship, all the kind of things. Davey will explain a wee bit more about each of his businesses as he's explaining, and we're talking through some of the concepts of business. And so if you've got an interest in becoming an entrepreneur, setting up, this is the podcast for you. Okay, so how you doing, Davey?
I'm great, thanks. It's lovely to be in your company once again. I'm looking forward to a nice detailed discussion, a bit of banter and a good chat about one of the biggest passions in my life, business.
I like it. So if you just can you just a wee summary of, you know, folk will be saying maybe businessmen, how long you've been in business, what is the various companies that you have, to give us an idea of again who we're listening to.
Okay, so I've been an entrepreneur, I've been a businessman for 8 years now, running my own company, my primary company. And the one I suppose I'm most well known for is DMC Fitness in Glasgow. We're a private gym, so I created and built my own facility. I have 7 employees, and we opened that gym only, well, for our 4th birthday in Halloween in October. The 31st we actually started with physical people on the gym floor. So in that space of time I went from 2 employees to 7, so I've had quite a big growth, grown the company by over 200% in that time. My second company is Magic Minds, where I deliver one-to-one type mind coaching to entrepreneurs and executives, predominantly athletes and people with weight disorders and individuals who've had kind of abusive relationships. Individuals who've had abusive relationships in the past, either with themselves or have suffered some sort of abuse. And Ubuntu Promotions is a public speaking seminar company, and I also have an arm of that that deals in supplements and vegan and vegetarian friendly supplements that I use personally, but also that the students within the gym and the people within the gym use.
That's quite interesting, vegan and vegetarian. That's maybe for another podcast. I think that would be a good day to question the whole veggie vegan, but I know that you're not a veggie or a vegan, but
no, I just have these are cleaner, you know. These are the supplements that I prefer to use, and the ones that I encourage our clients when they come in for weight loss, because most of them are nutriently deficient. I try and get the cleanest sources, the ones with the least amount of ingredients, the ones with the least amount of process within them, that kind of thing, you know.
So, with regards to business, I'm in business myself. I've been in business for 9 months. For anybody who's in the working environment or they're unemployed and they've got a passion, they've got a dream, somebody's maybe said to them, you know, that sauce is fantastic, or that skill that you have is fantastic, you should make some money, you should go at it, or you just have enough with a normal day working for the boss. And what would be your base foundation of taking that first step and thinking about what do people have to think about from the foundation of moving into becoming a self-employed or setting up a company?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think the most important thing that anybody who decides to take the jump has to do is to hire a coach. Hire an experienced coach who has a proven track record, because there are so many coaches now with the way social media is and how the environment and the demographic of the business world has completely changed. It's that we'll never go back. You can have your own radio show like we've got here. You know, you can have your own TV show now. You don't have to go to the gatekeeper. And so there's so many people saying that they can do this and they can do that. For the individual, that, because you gave me two different types of people there. For the individual that loves something, like anything in any industry, it could be hairdressing, it could be jewellery, it could be putting on makeup, it could be framing pictures, it could be whatever it is, you know, that this person loves. If they can say to themselves that they would be quite happy doing that every single day, where they would get up with passion and purpose, and they would put pride in what they were doing, and feel free at the same time, then by all means, go for it. But what they'll find in the barrier they'll come up against is fear, which, you know, a really good acronym for that is false evidence appearing real, because it's not real. But they've all come up with that because I've coached quite a few people.
But that fear is real. And one of the things that I heard when I was, I've done a few things, but one of them was a canyon, and the canyon gap is 6 feet, you know, between two big high cliffs, and you fall to your death, and you can't take a small step to cross the canyon. You literally need to run at it and jump. And I think fear, sometimes you can't take small steps into fear. You need to.
No, you need to commit fully. If you're the individual that will put this into bracket A, if you're the individual that falls into this bracket of loving what they do and believing that they can make a living for themselves, as if they can enjoy life and do this at the same time, then boom, they need to make that breakthrough. And yes, you need to go. You need to commit wholeheartedly. You know, it's a 100%. To take the island, you need to burn the bridges. For the other individual that we talked about, say category B, for the person who's just pissed off, you know, doesn't like working for the man, has a knob of a supervisor, hates the alarm clock going off, you know, maybe very financially rich, but absolutely pissed off at where they find themselves, because I've been in situations with all those types of people where I've coached them through their challenges. Then if that person's not living to purpose, or if that person's that pissed off, then they need to make a change as well. However, that same barrier will come up. I suppose category A, or the first person's doing a passionate thing, they're following their passion. The second person's pissed off and angry, so they're not happy where they are. Now, for that person, I would be saying to them, find out why you're not happy. What is it you're not happy about? And then try and become person A. You know, and find a passion, find something that you can, find something that you know that you can do every day, even when it gets fucking tough. Even when, you know, the shit hits the fan, as it will do during your journey. But the most important thing, definitely find a coach who comes with a personal recommendation from somebody you've seen become successful, or somebody with an exceptional proven track record where you can actually interact and talk to their clients. There's some exceptional people in Glasgow. My coach was Forbes Bryce from Freshwater Business Coaching, and he definitely was one of the most influential and important people to come into my life when I first just opened my wee studio, you know, about 6 years ago.
It's quite an interesting concept to find a coach, because obviously, for me, in 9 months in business, I've never even thought about finding a coach. But if I put it into perspective of the other skills that I've learnt, like grappling, or you know, if I was going to learn skills to be a car mechanic, you know, you're finding somebody who has these skills, has that experience, and it has a proven record, and then can show me the foundations, you know, how to build a wall, how to build a roof on the wall, how to build my chimney. And I think from a novice in business, I'm still at the passion perspective. You know, I've not got to that, how do you build a solid foundation? And that's that's been a already 10 minutes in a bit of an epiphany, having a direct coaching kind of experience.
Yeah, so it was the most, it has been by far the most important thing that happened to me. And I met Forbes at a networking group, and he was nice to me, and I was really like shy, and Bannatyne's was just closed, and I was either to go with the rest of the guys into another commercial gym or do my own thing. And I'd been working for Dung Bannatyne on commission, and I'd made him like 10 grand on commission, and I'd made a few grand for myself plus my wages, and I thought to myself, I can live off that. Back then I was renting out a room in my mate's flat, and I was training as a cage fighter and mixed martial arts 20 hours a week. I didn't have a regular bud. You know, I was 27, 28 years old, did not long come out of the army, transformed my life, which is another story and maybe another podcast for us to know about. And I didn't really have a huge amount of responsibilities. So I was like, well, I'm going to do this anyway, and I'll get 6 months. You know, and if it doesn't work, then I'll just go back. You know, I'll go back the way. But actually, once I've moved forward, I started my business with £100 in my back pocket on the 6th of January, 8 years ago. We'll be 8 years old in January coming. You know, and I was just passionate. I then met Forbes about a year after that. A year after that, yeah, when I met him. And I remember my first session, and he said, what's your average value sale? And I was like, huh? Like, you're talking about, oh, you're not going to get me to do mathematics here, are you? Because, you know, I'm kind of, as we know now, after the assessments last year, I'm heavily dyslexic. So I was like, numbers and stuff. Oh, man, then he was like, well, how much do you charge per hour? And at that point, I was charging Daddy. 30 quid. James, I'm doing an interview. Sorry, guys, my wee three-year-old son's decided just to turn up and tackle me with his toes. Go play, please. I'll get the biscuit. So yeah, what's your average value sale? And I was like, well, I charge £30 an hour. And he went, no, what's your average value sale? And it turned out it was about 13. Once we took all the costs off, and once we, you know, we deducted all the running costs, I was working for £13 an hour. And I was like, quite shocked. But I have to say, in the first 8 months, that went from £17 to not far away from 40 in 8 months. Of me working with a coach. I will promote Forbes because he's phenomenal. Yeah, he's my go-to guy. Since then, I've been involved travelled all, you know, I've been on an amazing journey of development with people from Tony Robbins to Dr. Bangor to Andy Harrington at the moment, my closest mentor that I'm working with, and heavily invested in my own development. But at the beginning, it was Forbes, and he also helped me take on my first employee, which, for somebody who's thinking about starting a business, the first hurdle you have is actually making the jump, not being an employee anymore, okay, and paying your own wages. That, in my mind, this is how I process this, it's you're self-employed, okay. Then you become a business owner when you own a business, so you have an office, or you have an actual place of business. You need to take on your first employee, and then you need to establish your business, because it has to go through all this growth that it has to. It's like a baby, so that we did. It's just been an out there, you know, a brand new business, just kind of shits money. You know, babies just eat, sleep and shit. You know, nappy, dirty nappy every 2 hours. Man, business, a brand new business is just the same. So then you establish a business. You get your running costs, and you go through VAT thresholds, say, for talking, say, you know, when you start making more than 90k a year turnover, and then all of a sudden the government are pumping you, and you need to make more money just to stand at the same rate. And then, once you've got to that level, then you become a successful, established business, and that is the way that, so that's the way I look at this, you know, and there's the kind of different levels to get to, but you can make loads of, you can just try and date yourself, right? You can, but you make loads of mistakes. And Forbes talks to me about how he pretty much doesn't go near anybody that's not been in business for 3 years and made it through that first three, you know, and they've made that many mistakes, and they've done so many different things wrong, that it's like, right, I'm not doing this right. So then you can take that individual and nurture them a bit quicker. And I can understand that as well, you know, because at the start, it's all about you and your passion for business. But we talked about this earlier on before we went live. You have to be a master of all trades and a jack and run. And in order to become good at all these different things, because you need to be a bookkeeper, you need to be a marketeer, you need to be up to date with social media trends, you need to be product design, you need to have a good graphic design team behind you, you need to have a great website that's mobile responsive. Well, you might need to take a look into things like how to do Google pay-per-click. And if you don't have a huge amount of cash flow sitting there, you need to fucking do all that yourself. Because these people that are good at it, they want big money. And they want paid straight away. So, it's not as simple as just, like, cool, no, I'm going into business. I think the stats are 9 out of 10 fail in the first 3 years. 9 out of 10. 9 out of 10 people that start a business fail in the first 3 years. And I would say the reason that happens is because they don't invest in learning how to do it properly.
I think
or
then
to be a business person or an entrepreneur, if we're going to use the nice phrase. You know, some people think that's a bit wanky, but I like it.
No, I think entrepreneur term or any of these terms are pretty good, but the stat I heard was the first 2 years, something like 70% can fail within the first 2 years. And my own experience, you know, Big Ross Hot Sauce, it only lasted 6 months. That was my first venture into business, and it was getting past the tape, yep. And getting past a lot of the official red tape stuff to do with food manufacture on a shoestring budget, and being the first business kind of thing. The bit I shied away from was the huge investment that it would require to make a food manufacturing business competitive. But the competitors, when I started to analyse it, the real competitors are Heinz and Hellmann's, and you can't compete with them from your kitchen. So my
Would Levi Roots agree with that?
Well, Levi Roots, so he had a very unique opportunity where he sold a big part of his business, but I never got to the point of creating that into a limited company. I was just as a sole trader, but for the hot sauce, what I'm getting at there is the ability to fail and the ability to say, well, okay, I've learnt so much from that.
Oh, of course.
There's so much research, and there's so much to do with even just things like official stuff, you know, the next time, because Big Rob's Hot Sauce will come back.
Well, this is my question, sorry for cutting in, but my question was going to be, you said fail, I would just say paused.
Something that's a hiatus.
Yeah, because I don't think it's ever failure. It's never failure, it's outcome. There's either a positive or a negative outcome. And generally, when it's positive, you don't learn anything. No, one of my close mentors, the guy I mentioned already, Andy Harrington, he's got a really cool quote, and he says, either win or learn. You know, either win or learn. And I'm sure that, because I've tried your hot sauce, is awesome, and I'm sure that when that comes back in, then, you know, you'll be able to, you know, take that forward to the vision and to the dream that you had for it, because you already got it that far. It's just, as you say, stumbling blocks.
It's about learning. That's the Ken, what you were saying there about the like the first part. Like, I entered into a business of manufacturing hot sauce with no actual concept of business, no concept of numbers, no concept of the time of production, no concept of the distribution, and no concept of what the can the retailers wanted to purchase it for. And when they wanted 50% of, they wanted 50%, and I was like, you can't be wanting 50%, that makes it non-viable for me. And they're like, that's
when
the price.
Volume, and that's when you need to be doing high volume on the scale. And then, you know, but what a great learning curve for you. And the best thing about it was that you followed your heart, because you're already a very successful videographer, and you've got a successful media company, and you're multi-award winning, and I know how good you are because you're part of my team within your own, obviously, self-employed basis. But you still followed your source team, you know? And then, but you also had the media stuff to fall back on, because you know that, and me personally, I believe as your friend and also as a colleague of yours, I think that's where your focus, you know, should be, and that's why the source thing didn't kick off right away. But what a great learning curve. However, put that in somebody else's shoes. Put the person that's just, you know, walked out of security, because that's the thing, right? I was out for a meal with Stuart and Emma a while ago, really good friends of ours, and they also come to the gym, but we became really great friends. And Stuart, and they're both really quite successful corporate executives, in a corporate executive role. So like, you know, if DJ Stephen Kirkwood was here, he'd be talking about, you know, they work for the man, and they do. And Stuart had said to me, you know, it must be great. And I was like, well, I was having a few pints, and it was quite well loud. It must be great, you know, just being able to do your own thing. And I said, well, see, you swap what you do for a guaranteed wage. You swap what you do for security. You swap the, you know, 50, 60, sometimes 70 hours a week that you put in because of the level that you're at within the organisation for the opportunity to be able to go to holidays a year, free holidays a year sometimes. Nice holidays, skiing holidays, sunshine holidays, you know, that kind of stuff. You know, I don't have that opportunity because I don't have the certainty of money coming in. I don't have any of that. But what makes it worthwhile for me personally, and anybody else that I know that's in the same situation that we're in, and this is an important part, guys, if you're thinking about your own business, you are free. But your trade-off for that freedom is complete uncertainty. Nothing is guaranteed at all whatsoever.
Ever.
And you have to be able to hustle. You have to, even more so now, you need to be able to hustle more, because everything's at a fingertip. You know, you want to find out if anything's any good? Go on Facebook reviews. You know, back in the day, you would go to buy, I'm going to sound a bit old here, I'm nearly 40, but you go buy a telly, you would go into, where's the one that went bust? Is it Comet? It went bust, Comet, Curry's. Comet. Right, you would get into Comet, and the guy would be there, and they'd be like, you know, here comes my commission. Like the guys that are still game, you know who I'm talking about. Like, no one else, you know, and you would go, and he was like, I'm here for a telly. Whereas now, it's just pick your phone up, you know. Okay, what's the best telly? Everything is at the fingertips.
And you're only going to PC World or Curry's to actually look at it physically, yes, before you buy it online.
Aye, because it's cheaper before you get Amazon to deliver it, because, you know, their service can be even better, even though there's nobody even physically there. So that's a thing as well, you know, coming into business, because you are so easily accessible now, eh? And anybody and everybody's reviewing everything. You know, and I would say as well, because I've made some absolute belter mistakes, you're only as good as your last mistake. But what I have always consistently been able to do is look after my customers, get great results, create what I believe to be world-class products, you know, that produce phenomenal results. And again, we've got a proven track record here, so I'm not just like Tarzan and beating my chest.
Oh, definitely.
That's an important part as well, because it's okay to say that you're good at what you do, eh? Back in the day, you would land on a website, or you would go to and it would be sales copy, and it would take you on a wee journey, and it'd be a, you know, a big long sales page, traditional sales page, buy now button at the bottom. Like, that stuff's gone. You know, people don't want to be sold to. They want you to educate them. And because of all the kind of way social media is now, and especially technology, you need to give lots of stuff away. You have to, you know, share your information. You have to share your knowledge. You have to turn the prospect or lead into a friend first before they become a customer, and you need to engage them so that they know, like, and trust you before they're going to then buy your product. And all that kind of stuff is a minefield for mistakes, yeah, because you're going to have to fail your way forward. You need to, you're not just going to wake up one morning and all of a sudden, boom, it's there. You know, like, your business is going to develop and grow as you develop and grow. And if you're not willing to develop and grow, if you're not willing to get out there and trial things and make mistakes and measure and get mentors and, you know, go on courses and delegate when you can and build cash flow and all these other things, then you're going to become one of the 70%, 7 out of 10. 7 out of 10 people have the balls and the guts to chase their dream, but don't fucking make it. And in my opinion, me, just based on the short business life I've had and what I've done, it's because they don't invest in coaching. They see it too much as how much is that going to cost? I see it all the time. How much does that cost? Well, why don't you look at that as an investment? You know, how much does that cost? Or, and that's the basic, kind of, actually, you're kind of novice, or you're, you know, 1 year in business, what's that cost? Instead of, okay, how quickly can I liquidate that cost? That's going to cost me such and such. Okay, how many sales do I need to make? Initial sales. And then you need to think about the lifetime value of the customer and the customer relationship. You look after that individual properly. Not only will they still be your customer and your payments will compound, yeah, for product or service, but they will then refer you to their friends and your business grows that way. But if you don't look after them in the first place and you don't know how to nurture that relationship and you don't know how to be good at customer service and you don't know how to, you know, wow people with your product, with your service, with your experience, with the environment that they train in, with your engagement, which is something that I'm working on at the moment, actually, my engagement, because my engagement could be a hell of a lot better. Post a course that I've just done. Yeah, there's all these.
It's good
these things to think about. But again, don't be fucking sitting going, oh shite, I'll not be able to do that. Yeah, because you can't, as Steve Jobs says, you can't join the dots looking forward, you can only join the dots looking back. So you have to believe in yourself, and you have to have faith, non-religious faith, or religious faith if that floats your boat, to just believe that you can do it, and see it first, see it, and dream about it, and work, and just go for it, man.
I think within that last sort of like 5 to 10 minutes, so many kind of nuggets of quality information. I think for anybody listening, to maybe listen to bits again, but to take in that you're not going to get all of what you just said there in terms of, I think there's, for me, various bits there on different levels.
Yes.
And indeed. And as you're going through the kind of process of business, of learning new skills, of because I suppose that's the interesting thing about business. Just say that you're a frame maker, again, how much skill is involved in that, and then put that to side, then business, how many specialisms within that thing do you need? You know, as you've said, your finance, you've got to know your numbers, you've got to have the confidence, you've got to have the ability to fail and get back up, you've got to have the right people surrounding you, you've got to be able to seek the right information, you've got to talk about web presence and social media skills, and there's so many branches on the tree,
yep,
that you have to look at. But at the same time, I think for anybody listening, anybody who's thinking about starting a business, that all the different trees, all the different branches will come when you take that first step.
Yes, there's some core elements. If I was going to, because I do, you know me, I like to chat, and I'm quite tangenty, you know, I go away and what's a different
digress.
I digress quite quickly. Yeah, this is the way that I am.
It's the way the best minds are.
Thank you, Rob. Core values, they are the core elements. Right, so the first thing you've got to have is a product. I'm going to stick to the P's here. Right, I'm going to make this. I'm going to stick to the P's. First thing you need to have is a product. Do you need to have a product or service? But even your service should be in a product. That's how I was able to put my foothold in the health and fitness industry, especially within Glasgow. Just a little digress here for 30 seconds. We have 29 competition, well, soon to be 30, because Pure Gym's just opening 5-minute walk. But before that, was opening a 29 competition, 9 of them are multinational chains with multi-million pound budgets, you know, or £100,000 budgets for marketing, all within less than a 10-minute walking distance in my facility.
So these are like huge chain gyms that are
David Lloyd,
generic way, a 100 piece of equipment. Yeah. And
David Lloyd, Virgin Active, the Nuffield, you know, three of the bigger hitters. And then you've got your Pure Gym, you've got the kind of the gym,
so,
and then you've got your smaller places as well. And the point I'm making there is this product. I looked at the industry and I decided I wanted to create my own product, which is a flagship 12-week program. And I made the first one, which is Mark 7. Mark 1 was last year, Mark 7 was just, I guess, reviewed every 6 months. And that's why I believe that I was able to cement my foot within such a close-knit competition. I mean, that competition level would freak most people out, whereas somebody could open next door to me and I really would not be bothered, because I have the confidence in my product that I created. So the first thing talking about is product. Create a great product, whatever that is, even in a service environment, because personal training is a one-to-one service. I created a product and I've refined it, and it's an exceptional product, and the results speak for themselves. With the thousands of lives that I've touched and all the other stuff that comes with our story. The next thing you need to be able to do...
And I just caught in there with the product. There was a thing I heard at a lecturer at university many years ago, and he says, everybody used to brush their fence, can creosol or can weatherproofing paint, they brush their fence. Yep. And he says, a company brought out the exact same product, the exact same paint, but they changed the delivery system. They had a pump and a spray, and they took the market share. He says, when you enter into business, most of the things that you're about to do will already be there, but it's how you change the delivery system, or how you change up the market. For like the one I've seen lately, that Graze box, they sell nuts, and they're selling the same thing that everybody else sells, but the difference is their delivery system. They've got a subscription, deliver it to your door, you sign up for 12 months,
it's hassle-free, you go to the shop, you
so they've changed it, it's the but same it's thing, the same it's product. Nuts and raisins and...
Yeah, but we deliver personal training. Yeah. It's personal training. Every single facility that I talked about deliver personal training. Yeah. However, I believe our product's different. I do.
You've changed the
I turned it into a vehicle. I gave it an actual there's an educational process.
So Joe Blogs, does they just walk in, work away, get frustrated and leave and see no results
and still stay locked into, you know, even the ones that say they don't lock you into a contract, you try and get out of a certain company's contract and I tell you 5 months down the line, because I know you're still trying to get it, and you don't want to no pay, because if you don't pay, then you get black mark on your credit, and then you might not get a mortgage or whatever, you know. So, yeah, most of my industry that I've seen, not this is quite global, so I'm not saying it's 100%. I'm just saying my humble opinion. Most people sell service, and that's what I thought was missing back in the day. That's what I thought was missing personally. I was like, there's no product here. Also, I needed something to pitch. I wanted something physical that I could sell. I was working at the Barra's market, you know, on a phone stall. giving it the whole way. Yeah, there's SIM cards now, two for a pound, and a SIM card. You know, that's where I learned how to do things here, you know, how to deal with people.
That's real world sales, you know.
It's a Barra's market. I mean, you're not Harrods, darling. You know, so real people
in.
And it gave me something to be able to pitch from. It gave me a tool to be able to, you know, say, well, this is what you're going to get. And I undervalued it, and I never charged enough, and I did all the classic mistakes that everybody has to learn through. And so it's the product, the first P, product. Then you need to learn how to present it, right? You must be able to present your product. You must be able to stand with confidence and passion and pride and present what you do. Not just what you do, but how it's going to add value to that individual that's coming to you for product or services life. How are you going to improve them? What is it about what you do that's going to wow them to make them want to swap their hard-earned cash for said product stroke service? And how is it going to be better? Because I tell you what, there's some phenomenal products out there that people have made, but they're too scared to sell it because they don't want rejected. There's a fear of rejection, big fear here. You know, lots of fears hold people back in business. Oh no, they might reject me, so do you know what? It's fucking easier not to try and sell it in the first place. And again, selling's presentation. So how do you present it? And there's so many different things to do with that without being a snake oil seller, you know, without, you know, using Chiardini principles to be able to, you know, like car salesmen do, and there's loads of tricks and sleight of mouth and all the rest of it. You know, I feel 100% hand on my heart that I am a noble salesman, and that we offer our services with passion, and, you know, 6-7 out of 10 people sign up. 3 years ago it was 9.5. I had a 97% conversion rate, but that was because my product was far too cheap, and I was too inexperienced. I was going to say stupid there, and I had to check myself. I was too inexperienced to understand that was a sign that it was too cheap. Yeah, I was dead excited about that, you know, and I was kind of, wow, you know, 9 out of 10 cats prefer my scores, and it was 9 out of 10 people prefer DMC when they come along, or buy DMC's product, the fitness product. So, how you present, huge, massive, you need to be a salesperson. You have to believe in what you're doing and how you're going to add value to people's lives. And you have to see that transaction as you are going to educate, inspire, develop, you know, improve their existence, their life, you know, their life going forward in some capacity for the exchange for a fee. And then you need to present the right fee as well. So, you know, you've talked about presenting the product, you need to present the right fee. And that's a nice learning curve as well. You know, being able to actually see what you're worth. Like, how you value yourself. The big, big learning curve I had in the last couple of years. Massive, in fact. You know, and somebody had to rattle my cage about that. You know, I was in a coaching session where I spent thousands of pounds to spend a day with one person, one day, like thousands of pounds. You know, not tens of thousands of pounds, but thousands of pounds to sit with somebody and for them to tell me, "You're stupid," for me to go, "Well, actually, yeah, you're right." And he never said I was stupid. He just put a mirror in front of me and I was like, "What the fuck? Really?" You know? So we've got presentation. Yeah, we've got product. We've got presentation. We talked about price. Yeah, pricing. Yeah. And then you've got point of sale, which again is, you know, how you deal with that individual, how you take the transaction, you know, is it online, is it in person, you know, all that kind of stuff needs to be kind of focused on as well.
So
I did 4 P's, because I'm getting quite excited about this, and I love business, I love talking about things I'm passionate about, and I really love business, love it. I try to keep it simple because that's geared towards the novice individual that's trying to come in. Those four, I would keep those four just basics. product, how it's presented, the price point and the point of sale transaction, as in, you know, when you're taking the money, having the confidence to take the money. I used to be scared to ask people for money, for their fees. I used to worry about it. You know, instilled to this day, I'll say to somebody, and I've got people that have been training with me for 10 years, who were training with me before I was self-employed, who are still there and still enjoying the process, and I'm still saying to them, is it your intention to carry on? Are you happy with the service? First, are you happy with the service? Is there anything that we could do better? Are you intending to stay on? And most of them just laugh at me. And they go, really? Like, I've been here for, you know, I've been here for 6 years, Dave, man. Of course I'm staying on, you know. But I never make a presumptuous sale either. You know, I'm never going to presume that an individual's, you know, still wanting to buy what we're doing. And that's a kind of process that you learn as well, but shy to contact. I've got a company I'm working with just now, not going to mention them, it's a young company, they're doing great service, and they sent me products that I asked for, that I'm happy with, but I've not followed up yet, and it's 3 weeks down the line and I've still not followed up because they're scared I'm going to say I don't like it, and I've not paid them yet. I'm happy, I'm going to email them today, I've got a backlog, I've got to catch up, and they should be on top of that. As soon as that email was sent, invoice should be in. Yeah. And that's just because, you know, that's what I'm talking about, the whole point of sale process as well. How do you get your money? You know, you need to get your money. And you need to get your money quick, because every pound's a prisoner at the moment, especially with the demographics and media and all the rest of it. And the more experienced business people will make you wait longer. And the bigger companies, like when you work for like a Virgin Media's, and kind of health education board and people like that, they make you wait 60 days. And sometimes you forget, because Virgin Media forgot to pay me. You know, they just, there was an administration error which was sorted very, very quickly because I am closely linked to a big player in that company, hence why I was given work in that environment. But yeah, you know, so.
Everything there has been fantastic. Ken, the ideas, I think, Ken, and they're listening myself, Ken, from a perspective of you're looking at business, it's, my eyes have been opened again. I'll have to listen through that a few times and take some notes and then expand that from my own perspective. When you... So just say that you sat down at the beginning, you had your product, you talked about service.
Remind me, I've got a product.
You had your product. How did you, like, the whole idea of goals and saying, you know, I'm here, I'm a one-man personal trainer. I want to be, you know, my own facility, purpose-built with my ideas. In X amount of time, I want to have X amount of staff, X amount of equipment, and then in 10 years I want to have multiple gyms in different locations. Did you set out goals like that? Again, is that a part of your initial, or are you, well, that makes sense.
Yeah, no, it makes complete sense. So, I fell in love with industry when because I was 20 stone and I had my challenges with drug abuse and homelessness and the previous challenges that I had in my previous life, and came out of the army very fat and very overweight and very uneducated and very with no prospects. You kind of know about that story anyway. Most people do, it's on the website. dmcfitness.co.uk, and I fell in love with exercise. I fell in love with martial arts. I lost nearly 6 stone in 8 months. I ran the Great Scottish Run. I put myself into night school and I worked through HND, which was the hardest thing that I did. It was horrible, and I didn't know I was dyslexic. I've only just found out last December, as you know as well, because we've talked about this. So, you know, and had I known then, I would have not had to do any written work at all. You know, and I would have had a reader and a scribe, and all my exams would have been done in softer environments and all that. You know, and I managed to drag my way through that because I wanted into the industry, because I fell in love with training. I fell in love with exercise. Exercise was my angel. And I thought, well, do you know what? I remember going along for my interview for my HMD. I'd been to night school and studied at Glasgow Uni while being a security guard and having to deal with some real serious criminal gangs in Tucky Hall Street, threatened to get slashed at night and told I was getting done in, and, you know, got all sorts of nonsense going on while I was trying to do a 70-hour week as a security guard, train and also educate myself, because I had no qualifications. And I got accepted to Glasgow Uni to study English literature, because I've got my poetry gets published, and I've been writing since I was about 13. I've been published in a few different, like, Times newspaper, The Guards Journal. I've got 56 anthologies that I'm published in. It's urban, it's raw, it's real in your face. It's, you know, there's some romantic stuff in there, but very, very, very few. It's kind of Irvin Welshy style, you know, fuck you world, you know, because that's how I felt at the time. And that was my reason for leaving the army. I was going to be a writer. And that was the only thing I was good at, the only thing in my life. So that was, I fucking zoned in on that, and it was like, wait, that's my focus. And then when I got into the night school environment, they were getting me to read prose fiction, like Joseph and Shamilla, and people were reading it in 4 days, and I was reading 4 pages in 4 days, like, what the fuck is this all about? Like, you know what I mean? And then they were coming in, and they were all discussing this book, and I'm like, and then Shakespeare, prose fiction and Shakespeare, I was just like, this is pish. You know, absolute pish. And I had to study politics as well, you know, and I never had a fucking clue about politics. But you know what? I got through it. And my flatmate at the time helped me with the exams, and I got through it, and I got accepted. And the reason I got accepted into Glasgow Uni was the reason that I got into college, because I never had the qualifications. I got an in-life experience and the fact that I could go to Glasgow Uni, which is, you know, I've got it framed on my wall. Was like, actually, the guy that was the so-called dumbass at school and would never be it and was accepted to one of the most prestigious educational facilities in the whole of Scotland. And that got me into college. And my life had transformed. I became a better version of myself. Not so much in my head, because I never really knew about that then, but in my body. And exercise was just the thing that held me back. The thing that stopped me from getting a better career in the army. All the thing that I fucking hated, like completely hated, was the thing that had saved me. And I was like, wow, this is fucking awesome. If I can do this, I can do it, right? Then anybody can do it. And how can I then help other people? What can I do to be able to encourage, engage, inspire, motivate, educate, develop other people so that they can travel in the same vehicle, so that they can get the benefit of it as well, so that their lives can start to develop and grow and transform and move forward and expand. And you know, that was the start of the story. That was the real beginning. But, and I said, right, 5 years, to answer your question, 5 years, in 5 years time I'm going to have a place. That was all I said. I didn't know much about SMART goals, I didn't know about visualisation, I didn't know about the theatre of the mind, I hadn't read Psycho-Cybernetics by Dr. Maxwell Maltz, I hadn't engrossed myself in Think Rich and Grow Big by Napoleon Hill, I hadn't read James Allen's As a Man Thinketh, I hadn't read Schwartz's, you know, the Power of Thinking Big. I hadn't like thrown myself, I hadn't been on multiple Tony Robbins courses, I hadn't, you know, invested 15 or 60,000 pounds in learning to be able to go, right, where am I going next? It was just, I'm going to do that. And what I know now, the tactical activation system, and, you know, I know more of the technical aspects of, you know, how the brain works and stuff. That was my goal. And I achieved it. And then the real shit happened. You know, I wasn't doing process goals, I wasn't doing specific, measurable,
but you set realistic, a big goal,
timelined,
and the wee goals came through just the experience idea, of like, getting to that big.
Yeah, here's something really cool. I was at a Jack Black gig not so long ago, and Jack Black's pretty cool, mind store guy, he's awesome, man. Jack Black's the kind of Glaswegian, kind of minded, yeah, and he talked about, like, was Nelson Mandela's goal realistic? Was it? You know,
surviving in prison or changing
South Africa. Was his goal realistic? Was it specific, measurable, achievable, realistic in timeline? Was it fuck? I saw the whole understanding goal setting, understanding the process, understanding, you know.
Was Nelson's goal realistic?
No, was it fuck, man? Think about it. Man, the guy changed the whole country.
Buddha changed the religion of India within his lifetime.
Which is amazing.
Yeah, that's it.
And, I think the point I'm making there, or the point that we are discussing is, you know, dream big. You asked me, was it detailed? Did I have it all planned? Bam, 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 bam. No, I just said to myself I was going to do that. And then it happened. Because I knew what I wanted to do, and I knew where I wanted to do it, and I knew when I wanted to do it by, and I let the house take care of itself. And this has happened quite a lot in the last 10 years, about letting the house take care of itself, and I'm quite comfortable in the process now that, you know, that I do. But to having the gym, doing that, you know, I want that, that's what I want, and then I get it. Well, actually, then the real challenge begun, because building the gym nearly broke us. Building the gym was like, that was my dream, I want my own gym. I never had a fucking clue about, you know, running a facility. I never had a clue about the effect that tax was going to have. I was due a £12,000 VAT rebate, and they'd done me, and I got £1,750. I was desperate for that money at that time, and they pulled a clause. We took them to court. And at the time, the country was in recession, and there was just nobody was getting in. They said it was a standard upgrade to the unit when I'd done a full renovation. You know, £100,000 it cost us to build my gym. No funding, no government money, and then I'm in the door 2 months and I'm through that threshold. So then I have to start paying. So then I have to make more money that next month just to stay alive. And my missus walked out a really successful job as a bank manager, and my coach Grant walked out of his job, and they all came into my dream, you know. And then things happened, and I went backwards a bit, and I'd reverted to type, and was binge eating again, and alcohol abuse, and doing things that I shouldn't have been doing, but I didn't know how not to do, because that was how I'd coped previously. And that was when I started getting involved in mindset and working. And I'm Brian Costello from the Scottish Centre of NLP, and Steve Burns, and that was the Brian, and I was the first person to really start to push me towards learning about the mindset and learning about the subconscious, and, you know, doing the kind of courses that I've done that I then created Magic Minds around, you know, my second business.
So set a big goal.
Yes,
set a fucking huge goal.
No soft goals, guys.
Look for the sky. No soft goals. I'm in the gutter, but I'm looking at the stars.
Yeah. And Les Brown says, reach for the stars, reach for the moon, because if you don't hit the moon, you'll land amongst the stars. And another great quote from Les Brown is, you don't need to be great to get started, but you need to get started to be great. And a third one with Les is cool. I got a back massage off him in London last year. I went to his event, and he coached me most mornings just through YouTube, and, you know, every day that year. And then I went to his event and was just sitting, and he came over. He was the most humble guy I've ever met. So I've been in amongst these talk. These guys are big hitters in the personal development, you know, public speaking, motivational arena.
I think most people have heard of Tony Robbins and Les Brown. Yeah. You know.
Well, Les walks about the floor and comes and chats and sits beside you and talks to you. You know, whereas you can't get near Tony Robbins. You know, he's got security crawling about the floor of him everywhere he goes and all that. So, yeah, Les has got some great quotes. And the other one is, if you fall, make sure you fall on your back, because if you can look up, you can get up. And then, you know, and that's true, but, you know, no small goals, no soft goals. No, like, a big goal, but then again, don't...
I think, like,
don't think you're going to start a multinational company, you know, that's going to take over the world, you know, which, you know, this today, okay, what's your goal? My goal's going to be, I'm going to be the next Steve Jobs, but actually I don't like product design. You know, hey, I'm trying to be kind of, a bit, I'm being a bit stupid here, but I'm trying to kind of make it, it has to be realistic, I suppose, to you. There has to be something in it that, you know, that you can do, that you have a skill set within, you can develop and grow. And a really cool point here, I think, is money will not heal the soul. Money does not heal the soul. So if you're predominantly getting into something just to make hundreds of money, then, nah.
I think, like, Steve Jobs, he had a good response. Him and Bill Gates were sitting on the stage and somebody asked them about the kind of mentality of business and the kind of, how to sum it up in one thing. And he said, passion. He says, because when you're down, and you all be down, and you all get knocked down, and you all get knocked down, it's the passion which keeps you, kind of, his passion for Apple. You know, if he wasn't passionate about that, and he was just into computers because he thought he could make money, he wouldn't get back up for the 70th time. He wouldn't get back up. Yeah. Kenny would have just went for the shit. I'm going to work in corporate world and, yes, and make my money.
And swap time for money. Swap time for money. Definitely. No, you have to. I'm not going to tell anybody that it's easy, because it's not. And sometimes, you know, I find out how hard it is. Come speak to my wife, who's also my business partner, because she's the administration dynamo, she's the finance director, she's the clever. Well, I remember she keeps a note up, you know, she's the one that helps within the infrastructure of the business, because she's the manager, stroke leader in a wee, whereas I'm the artist. Seth Godin talks about this, there should be three people in a business. There should be an artist, there should be a manager, leader, and there should be an entrepreneur. And the way you know if you're not an entrepreneur is if somebody said to me today, right, I'll buy your business for £1 million, I'd say no. An entrepreneur would say yes. Definitely. I'm not saying my business isn't worth money, but we're going through a growth stage and things are, it's been an interesting 3 years, shall we say.
I've read a fair bit on that kind of mentality, and there is that kind of mentality within a lot of your self-help business books that I buy off the shelf, of that idea that a business sole purpose is for you to sell it.
Yes.
And that kind of idea, yep, of, well, I'm building this business, I'm passionate about it, but I'm building it so I can sell it. And I think that comes through the kind of technology sectors, yeah, are real big on, yeah, this kind of like Twitter, WhatsApp. Yeah, a lot of these big companies are looking for the next, enhanced video app or the next social app that is, I think it was WhatsApp or one of these ones that had the customer base that Facebook never had. They wanted that, yeah, and that was the WhatsApp whole strategy, was basically, we're going to, let's look at Facebook, let's look at Twitter, let's look at YouTube. What have they not got, but can be integrated seamlessly into what they do have, so that when it becomes successful, it's a quick, easy sale to the big...
No, totally. I think that's an important part there as well. You've got a passion business and you've got a product business. It so happens that we're talking about a passion business. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't be passionate about your product. I know what my next business will be. It's food. I'm not going to mention, I'm not talking about it. I've been dreaming about it for the last 3 years. I know it will happen. And that will be an exceptionally enjoyable experience for anybody who comes into my restaurants. By far, amazing. However, it will be a business that will feed people, make them feel happy, and will make lots of profit from it. Because I want to set my children up. Because I've made so many mistakes not making profit. I've been through that whole, my passion drives me, my passion gets me up, my passion pulls me through the darkness, my passion gets me through the, we've got 7 wages to pay next week, and I'm proud to say that I have never been late once in my life, ever, been late with my employees' wages, and we went from one employee to 7 in the space of 3 years, and that's a big PAYE bill, and that's a big... No, that's a huge growth spot. Yeah. but I've managed to do it. So, and again, there's times where you're talking about, see, you're talking about business here, you're talking about being an entrepreneur, where you've got that entrepreneurial mind, where you're not the artist, where it's like, okay, you know, it's all about numbers, it's all about profit margins, it's all about, you know, cost of sale, it's all about the kind of more stuff that you need to know, definitely, and stuff that will make you financially wealthy, stroke free. But in my situation, and my business is, up until now, Ubuntu Promotions is a business that supplements the gym business. Yeah. Magic Minds is a passion business. BMC Fitness is a passion business. They're businesses that I've created because I want to serve and I want to help people. And I'm passionate about doing that. You know, I think that I was wanting to mention earlier on as well, you do not need to be perfect. We talked about my first ever booklet that I sold, and I did that myself in Word. It was rank rotten compared to the, you know, professionally designed and professionally bound, you know, product that we have now. But it still did a good job. It was littered with spelling mistakes and grammar mistakes, that's part of my dyslexia. I need proofreaders and I need and a bunch of outsource now. That's fine. But back then it was just, you know, so for somebody who's maybe tuning into this and thinking, right, I actually want to do this and go on this journey, I think people need to remember as well that I'm speaking with 10 years worth of experience, 8 years with my own business, but 10 years as a coach. 10 years I was delivering this product before I was doing it for myself, you know, so I can look back on 10 years. I started my second business 2.5 years ago to be able to pay for a business mastery course with Tony. I came back for Tony Robbins, UPW, and I said, really, I'm going to business mastery. And this will prove the whole what and when, forget about the how. And she was like, we're sitting here, actually, at this table. And she was like, we can't, there's a couple hundred pounds in that account, there's a couple of hundred pounds in that. And I was like, well, I'm paying a £500 deposit. And she was like, you can't do this. You need to remember, my Julie's detailed. She's a left brain thinker. I'm a right brain thinker. I live in my right brain. I live in my right hand side of my brain. I live in my imagination. I'm a daydreamer. I don't live in reality. I live in a wee world of Davy, you know, which is pretty cool a lot of the time, but can be quite lonely sometimes. And my wife's very analytical and she's very detailed and she's very processed, and she was going to be an accountant. She's an exceptional bank manager. An exceptional manager, great coach, a fucking awesome athlete as well. But she's very, you know, so she's like, how can you can't, like, then £7,000, that ticket alone, 7k to go on that course, Tony Robbins Business Mastery. And I was like, I will. She went, oh, you go do this, I'm going to open this new, see that spare room we've got in the gym, I'm going to create a business, I'm going to call it Magic Minds, and I'm going to help people think better, and I'm going to become a strategic problem solver, and I'm going to offer confidence boosting, and I'm going to offer sports development coaching, and I'm going to start studying about the mindset. I'm going to use my NLP techniques and my NLP qualifications, and I'm going to reach out to people, and I'm going to help them, and I'm going to create a library of books, and I'm going to kit it all out inside, and I'm going to help other people the way Brian helped me. I'm going to pay it forward, and I'm going to pay it back, and I fucking did. And I'm even getting excited talking about that, right? And that was like, God, I was passionate, I fucking got excited about, I can help people, eh? Put yourself in the public domain, people are going to have an opinion about you. That's another thing, guys, you need to be fucking thick-skinned. You do something that makes you a success and different for other people, people ain't going to like you. When you move forward, people talk about you behind your back. The reason they talk about you behind your back is because they are behind you. And they don't like it, and you're going to have to be able to fucking put up with that. You have to be able to carry that as well. And, you know, I know inside my heart that what I do is I do the right thing. I know why I do what I do. I know what drives me. I know what my purpose is. I know why I got up in the morning. And Jobs talks about Steve Jobs, the late great Steve Jobs talks about this. He says he asks himself every day, if today was the last day of my life, would I be happy doing what I'm doing? And if for too many consecutive days I hear no, I would go and do something else. And I have to say that yes, even when it's been horrendous, there's always been that, but the reason why is there. And you know your reason why I'm doing it, and my reason why for this is about improving people's lives to be mindless, being able to share what I experienced, being able to help other people, watching people develop and grow, watching the business develop and grow.
And having, I think, something like that at the core of your business, whatever your business is, be it a framemaker who wants to can make sure that people's memories are can best displayed in the wall, whatever it is, but having that kind of positive contribution to society at the core of, I think it's a good foundation for any business.
I think that's what kept it alive. I think that's what got it through the hard times. I think that was, definitely, but I think also that's what these bigger hitters, these you know, guys like your Steve Jobs and your Tony Robbins and all these type of people, when they talk about this, there's like, what's your, why? Like, for what purpose? Why are you doing this? You know, how is it going to impact and improve people? And that could be anything from, you know, my friend Louise, who's just opened a second dance studio because she loves teaching people how to dance, to a really, one of my best friends, Tommy, who's got an exceptional bathroom and a kitchen installations business. And, you know, when we say to Tommy, like, what business are you in? He's like, I'm in the business of making people happy. They go, people go, ah, I smile, because I know what he's talking about, because people that walk into his kitchens are happy. His kitchens make people happy. So he's in the business of making people happy. You know, and that and then there'll also be times where you'll maybe get taken off point, and they'll be like, oh man, what's the point of doing this? And, you know, all the struggles, and you'll be pulled out of your comfort zone and all that, but that's when you develop and grow.
I suppose that's the difference, my experience, and the difference from being self-employed to being employed by a company is you rock up 9 to 5 and you have been given a daily task, or you know that your job role is you've got a big event coming up in 3 months, you've got can this sort of thing, which is a part of your job role, your criteria, and you work through it, and you don't deal with finances, you don't deal with marketing, you don't deal with what the team leader or the management, or if that's your job, you deal with that, but there's so many different facets, you just channel in on your one thing, and when you need sort of reassurance, there is other people within that organisation, your manager, your get so and so who can redirect you to another task or redirect you. And when you're self-employed, when you hit them, you have to be able to, you know, take a deep breath, look at it, and look at the other things, and then regroup. The thing that for me, when I get to that place, is a Maori saying, and it's the thing that never changes is the fact that everything is always changing. Everything's always in trend, and can you make your nest or your tent in the middle of the storm? It's always, there's going to be ups, there's going to be downs, but can you bring yourself?
Yeah, can you be happy? You know, we cannot. I know we're getting towards the end of this. We touched a wee bit about exit strategy and, you know, building a business to be able to sell your business once it becomes profitable, and yes, that is very entrepreneurial, but there's also your business should give you the lifestyle that you want, you know, and your business a bit kind of further down the line, once you've built it, once you've mastered the skills, once you've understood how it works mechanically and then delegated out, once you can afford to delegate out, always find people that are better than you are at doing things and let them do it. My guys get complete autonomy. I hardly even speak to them. My business runs 100%. My gym runs 100% without me being there at all. I don't need to be there. In fact, it's grown this year. I've never been there because with 4 very close family deaths back to back, you know, which was rather fucking interesting as well. But that's another story. My business runs itself. I don't need to be there. I'm working on other projects. I oversee it. I don't need to be there. And that leads them to it. Because nobody wants a wanky boss that breathes down your neck. And again, the entrepreneurial people are 1% of the population. And my 50% is somebody else's 100%. And I see it and they don't see it because it's not theirs to see, if this makes sense. Yeah. So, what do you want from your business? Aye, here's a really good thing to kind of wrap it up with. You want to start your own business? Why? Why do you want to start your own business? How are you going to improve other people's lives with this said business, product, stroke, service? Yeah. What do you want from it? How do you want your business to serve you? See, I'm grateful and privileged because I get to spend just about every single day with my kids. Because I decided rather than opening a second unit, which we're in the process of doing, because I'm still clear of vision. My vision's still the same. My company vision's on the, as soon as you, my mission statement's, as soon as you walk in the door of the gym, on the left-hand side, the reception area, right across from all the transformation pictures, it's the exact same mission statement as I wrote 8 years ago. It's not changed at all, and it's still in place, and it will still happen. But I decided last year that I was going to start to work 2 days a week instead of 7, and allow myself that time to bond with my children before they went into full-time education, and my oldest boy's now in school. And my youngest boy doesn't go into school for another 18 months. So that's Daddy James time. That's watching Peppa Pig. That's, you know, taking them to the park.
That's the real value of working for yourself. Why do you want to get into doing it for yourself?
That's right. So what is it you want from it? How do you want your business? What do you want your business to provide for you? Do you want your business to provide you loads and loads and loads of money? Because I've seen those people. I've seen people chasing, I've seen people close to me chasing money where I couldn't say to that person, even though I have a love for that person, that's how close we are, couldn't say, because it wasn't for me to say to him, it was none of my business, even though I was there watching it all. I've seen people that have made hundreds of thousands of pounds come and ask me to have a chat with them and discuss the fact that they fucking hate their farm clock going off. Because when they got to that level of finance, it was like, what's the point?
Responsibility is so
I got here and actually that wasn't what I was looking for.
They just followed the path.
They thought that's what they wanted. And then when they got there, it was like, well, actually I'm here now, but I've realised that I've got all that, and I'm secure, but what's next? You know? So, what do you want? How do you want to contribute to society first? What difference are you going to make? You write a book, your book inspires. You cut a CD, or you get your music out there. You make people feel amazing through your music. You know, you open a restaurant and you feed people. You know, you train people. You teach kids how to dance. You know, you come up with an app, you know, which makes people's lives easier. You know, you're the best videographer. You are a lawyer who listens, cares and advises, like my close friend Billy Smith from Complete Clarity Solicitors. You make exceptional websites like the guys from Dodo Design Studio. You business coach people like Forbes Bryce. You know, you Downey Allison and Downey. You do lots of book binding and take people's library collections.
And I'm guessing this is a big part of business, the whole networking.
These are people that are close to me. I'm talking about them, but you know, they're all these individuals are all massively passionate about what Raymond Leslie Ann's passionate about, binding books. You know, so passionate about it. She's got a beautiful facility in Partick that I've seen pictures of, I'm going to go in person, that the stuff that they can do is phenomenal. That's her thing. You know, how does that make a difference? Well, think about it. The book that person can't touch because it's been in the generation of their family for 100 years or so, is then rebound and they get the enjoyment of being able to read that book. Now, who wrote the book and why did the person write the book?
No, to digress, I watched a fantastic video on book binding and it was about restoring old school books.
That's
and
what it, she does. And it was amazing.
I watched quite a lot of videos on manufacturing old school products like Damascus steel book binding, getting to, I can go on and on. I find the manufacturing process
fascinating to like kind of
how people make things. I'm going to wrap it up there, Davey. So you have
rambled and ranted for a maniac.
You have a kind of again, for anybody listening who is thinking about starting business, who is just starting business, to who is in business, I think it's going to definitely take away a lot of wealth from this podcast. The whole idea of the podcast is getting people to ask questions, to question everything, and there is a lot of questions in my own mind and anybody listening that will arise from listening to this podcast with regards to not just business, but your purpose in life and passion. And there's so many... the information that I've heard here, there's so many ways that you could utilise it to just make your life better, even if you're not looking to become an entrepreneur. There's kind of a lot of great bits. So what I'm looking for in the last 30 seconds, obviously, if you just hear us, all the information will be on the everythingsanillusion.com website underneath the podcast, you know, the links to Davey's company, his website and all that sort of stuff.
If there's just, a lot of questions,
you just use 30 seconds, it's a reverse elevator pitch, it's a close, a bit anything.
Make sure whatever you do makes you happy. It makes you happy. That's the key. Be healthy and be happy. And be true to who you are. Live a life of purpose. If that's being the best employee you can possibly be because you love the company you work for, great. Or if that's, you know, serving the world with your product, service or your story, then also great. Get out there and, you know, take life, be the director of your own story and make yourself the hero. And have fun. Be happy. Happy's the key. If it's not making you happy, there's no point in doing it.
Excellent. So just give us your three websites. Obviously all this information will
be DMC Fitness is DMC Fitness is the main one. Ubuntu doesn't have a website as such. It's a business within a business. It's a business within a unit. So I have three businesses that all trade out of 12 East Andyford Place. So www.dmcfitness.co.uk. And I have a suggestion. Do you've got questions? Yeah. If there are other questions that come in, then I would be happy to do a follow-up question and answer session where I answer the specific questions, in my own opinion. And again, everything I've said today is based on my own experience and my own personal and professional opinion, you know, from 8 years within this whole... I've not done a business degree. No, I haven't been to Business Gateway. No offence, Business Gateway.
I've been to Business Gateway and I found them quite good, the guy that I've been. So if folk going through your website, you know, I'm guessing you're quite accessible, you're quite active on Facebook and again social media. So
yeah, at DMC Fit on Twitter. Yeah. Better off if you come via my Facebook, DMC Fitness on Facebook.
Very approachable.
Or email.
And yep, so everythingsanillusion.com. I'm your host, Rob Wallace. That was a podcast with Davey McConaughey of DMC Fitness, Magic Minds and Ubuntu about business, starting up business. And I know that that's gave you a lot of food for thought with regards to how to set up your business, how to kind of push it through, passion, all these kind of things. I'll have another podcast up in a couple of weeks. Thanks for listening. I'm your host, Rob and Davey.
Thanks for having me.
Everything is an Illusion is brought to you by RobWallaceMedia.com, award-winning media, TheEnergeticMind.com, inspirational, motivational and thought-provoking art, and Health Made Simple. Buy today, change your life forever. HealthMadeSimple.info. Thank you, and remember, question everything.